Very good evening, everybody. Welcome. What a sentimental beginning, an empty campus of our university. It makes me a bit sentimental, actually. Welcome here this evening. Tonight, we will focus on the 1.5 meter society that we are all living in nowadays. Who invented this 1.5 meter? And is it actually safe to keep the distance of 1.5 meter? Why not 1 or 2 or 5? Detlef Loze will join us later via a video line to discuss this with us. He is an expert in physics of fluids and knows everything about how the virus could move through the air. But of course, there's also a lot of psychological issues linked to this issue. Marielle Stel is here in the studio. Welcome, Marielle.
Thank you.
A psychologist, director of education and psychology at our University of Twente, and she will share a lot of insights with us. So it's wonderful to have you here. But there is more. We will also have a pre-recorded item on a mentor app that was developed to foster the interaction between the students and their mentors, and also an item on the importance of physical exercise in the 1.5 meter society. And of course, it's important to tell you, you can ask questions on the chat online, and we will try to answer them if we can during this episode. But first, let's make the concept of the 1.5 meter society a little bit more specific. What does it mean for the University of Twente? What could a 1.5 meter lecture room, for instance, look like? How can this work in practice? Let's have a look.
Welcome in the design lab. We are here now with Rudy Oude Vrielink. Rudy is doing a PhD in the field of sensor technology. He uses sensor technology to scan how many people are in a lecture room, and he can determine the occupancy rate of the lecture room. Rudy is also director of a company called Twickle. It's written with a Q. And the company is specialized in giving advice on how to optimize spaces. And because of the corona crisis, Rudy started thinking and thought, well, maybe this technology can be used to establish a safe and sound 1.5 meter lecture room. So we're here with Rudy to talk about this technology and how it can be used to make a 1.5 meter room. Rudy, please tell us.
We looked at very different kind of sensors already available in the market, and none of them actually achieved what I wanted to do. So we developed our own sensor, which is just based on image processing, and what it does, it sees how many people are in the room. Since it uses image technology, we thought we can also use it to measure the distance between people. It is trained for recognizing people instead of chairs or furniture or iPhones or whatever. It is trained on recognizing people, so we can also use it to measure the distance between two people.
How about the privacy issues of this technology?
All the processing is done on the sensor itself. Mm-hmm. There's no image stored anywhere in this circle. Mm-hmm. It just gives the number of people that it counts after processing, and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Isn't it much easier to use just old school stickers or things like that instead of this complicated technology?
Yeah. Have you seen how much work it is to set up the chairs and place them in the right positions? And you're dealing with students. So the first thing they do is move the chairs around. Mm-hmm. If any opportunity, they will move around. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it is very hard to do that. By the way, stickers, well, yeah, where would you place stickers? On the chairs, and then you have someone on maintenance extra on your staff placing stickers,
yeah,
and then replacing them and maintenance for stickers. That is very, yeah, seems kind of silly.
Okay.
And quite expensive, a lot more expensive. If you use one extra person, then use my sensors,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
The initial setup is quite a lot of work, but after that, hardly any maintenance.
Okay, yeah. Thank you very much.
So, Marielle, what do you think? We're speaking about students, he said. Will this work in practice? I mean, in a supermarket, people don't even manage to keep a distance of 1.5 meters.
True. But I think this sensor and this technology is really helpful in making people aware when they actually violate a 1.5 meter guideline. So if it would give people a signal like, oh no, you're trespassing now, it makes people more aware of, okay, I should keep more distance because this is not 1.5 meter anymore.
Yeah, so the trick would be direct feedback, so you know, hey, I'm too close,
yes,
maybe I should back off.
Okay, yeah.
That's interesting. So do you think that actually this will also last. People typically get used to things that they don't like and maybe start to ignore signals. Would it be a risk that at some point we get used to the beeping noise and then we just stand closer? Or?
Definitely. So I think you should make the noise more annoying with time. But it can also become a habit. So we know that if 6 weeks you actually do the behavior consistently, it becomes automatic behavior. So then we get used to it and we actually stick to the 1.5 meter distance. So once we have these applications to help us, then we can become better at it ourselves as well.
It almost sounds like old-fashioned conditioning of people's behavior, right?
Yes, so that's really successful.
From my limited knowledge, I know that you can do reinforcement or punishment. And this sounds a bit like punishment, like you get a beep, you're too close. So could it also be positive reinforcement?
Yeah, positive reinforcement, of course, works way much better than negative reinforcement. But of course, having positive signals to your body through the sensor would be really weird when you keep the 1.5 meter
distance.
It makes
you feel good when you keep the distance.
Yes,
maybe.
Yes.
So how do you think the government deals at the moment with this 1.5 meter society? Do they do it well? Should they do something different?
Yeah, I think they're managing quite okay, although, of course, there's a lot of criticism from other people because, of course, all people know better than the government does. And it's kind of fluctuating. So in the beginning, they were kind of a bit struggling, but what should we do? How serious is the situation? But then when the situation turned really serious, they were quite clear, like, stay at home, keep a distance of 1.5 meter. And people actually also acknowledge the severity of the situation. And that helps if people understand how serious it is that they are also likely to get the coronavirus themselves. They stick to these rules.
Okay, so the idea is that people need to understand why they have to stick to the rules, right? So what's the best way for the government then to make them understand it? Is it also to make them afraid that they might indeed get affected, or is it more that they feel better when they stay home? How could you do that?
Yeah, both of these ways work really well. So one is indeed the fear. Increasing fear in people makes them indeed more likely to adhere to the rules. So that works really well, except when the fear is so high that people freeze and do not listen anymore to the message. And you should give clear guidance in what to do and what not to do and why you should do it, why these measures are also effective. And people should be able to think that they could also do this as well.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. So the idea is that it is doable.
Yeah.
You contribute to something good. Maybe you avoid other people getting affected. And also you might be saved yourself if you don't do that. Okay.
Yeah. Although people care more for others than for themselves, they do not think it's very likely they get corona themselves, but are very motivated to do this for other people. So this is also a way for the government to communicate this. Okay. Maybe you are not afraid, but make sure to keep your other people safe.
Interesting. Okay, so that could maybe be then the positive reinforcement that you suddenly, at some moments in time, are aware of the fact that you're actually contributing.
Yes, you're helping, and people want to help.
So on the basis of all these experience that we have gathered now, what would you advise to the board of the University of Twente? How could we have a 1.5 meter society, even though they now call it the 1.5 kilometer campus, which is a great slogan, I think, but a 1.5 meter university, what would that be?
Yeah, it would be quite hard. Of course, when students are in the lecture room, it's quite easy to keep the 1.5 meter distance. But you should also think about people having to go to the bathroom, maybe in between, and also having breaks, how to go to campus. So we need to think about how to keep people intrinsically motivated to adhere to these guidelines.
Yes.
That's very important.
Okay.
And of course, also design the environment as such so that people are aware of it. So when people make mistakes at a certain location, you can make sure to make lines indicating the 1.5 meters so that it becomes easier for them.
So that's where the stickers come in.
Yeah,
Peter Timmermans so nicely suggested.
We need a sticker person.
Exactly. So they're not entirely useless then. Okay. So
although with the app, it should also work, right? If it indicates, okay, now you're trespassing.
Yes, exactly. So do you have any idea where this 1.5 meter comes from? I mean, why not one of the World Health Organization says one meter is enough. People say, well, 1.5 meter is not even enough.
Yeah.
Do you have any
and
idea?
Sweden has 2 meters. I'm not sure why in the Netherlands it's 1.5 meter.
No, it's. I mean, I also feel that people really do not always stick to it. Again, nope. The supermarket experience tells you that it's quite hard.
Yes.
If you would really be very strict, then it would almost be impossible to do your shopping. So actually, Detlef Loze, who I already announced at the beginning of this episode, is an expert in the field of fluid physics. Especially in the behavior of little particles in the air, droplets that move through the air. And Detlef knows everything about this, I guess. So maybe he can enlighten us.
Yes.
Detlef, welcome. Wonderful that you can join. From your home, it's very nice that you can join the discussion. So can you tell us a bit more about where this 1.5 meter come from? Why 1.5 meter?
Well, the 1.5 meter is kind of random. It had been introduced in the 30s by Wells, who studied, in fact, the infection of tuberculosis. And he distributed droplets in small droplets and large droplets. And he thought, okay, the large droplets would be the dangerous ones. And 1.5 meter is about the distance where they reach ballistically. And the smaller ones, he argued, would somehow evaporate and then probably don't do too much harm.
Okay.
However, these days, in fact, already the last 20 years, we know that also the smaller droplets can, in fact, live for quite a while. And they live for quite a while because of humidity, because of other droplets. So a single droplet evaporates much faster than droplets in a cloud. And if someone sneezes or coughs, then, in fact, these droplets will stay around much longer.
Okay.
So, from my point of view, the 1.5 meters need not be safe inside when you have a huge accumulation of droplets. Outside, I think it's not much of a problem.
Okay, wow. So that's actually bad news, in a sense, because we are teaching inside. So the 1.5 meter university would actually, in your view, not be, by definition, a very safe environment to do your studies?
Well, there is good news, because you can protect yourself. And the good news is face masks. I mean, other countries all put their bets on face masks. Countries in Asia, they have been around for decades. Also, other European countries put their bets on face masks, apart from the Netherlands and Scandinavia, for reasons which I don't understand. So face masks, in fact, have three functions. First of all, the psychological function, that people realize that something is around. Second, the function of face mask is to reduce the amount of droplets which are released into the environment. And therefore, you can't inhale them, and you are safer. And the third function, of course, is protect yourself to some degree. Of course, a normal face mask wouldn't protect you for 100%, but if they protect you a little, it's already achieving something. But the crucial issue is the second issue. You want to reduce the number of droplets which are released into the environment and thus reduce the chance of being infected. And if this infection factor R goes down already a little bit, you achieve quite a bit. So the way to go is face masks. It's pretty clear.
Interesting. So at the background when you were speaking, there was already a movie that explains a little bit about what happens if we talk, if we sneeze. Maybe we can see that movie once again, and then you can explain what we actually see.
Well, I don't see it right now, but I've seen it many times.
Okay.
What we see is a person sneezing from the left to the right, and we see it in slow motion. And we see tons of droplets, small ones, large ones, and they hang around in the air for quite a while.
Okay.
The reason is humidity. They are not isolated. They come with vapor also out of your mouth. And therefore, these droplets live for quite a while.
Okay.
And when you inhale them, I think you're in deep trouble. So you really want to avoid and reduce this release of droplets into the environment. Okay. That's the way to go.
Interesting. After the sneezing person...
And it's not only sneezing. It's not only sneezing or coughing. It's also when we speak. It's also when we sing. I mean, this is where these outbursts of infections in churches and chorus and so on. So these are the dangerous situations, and you really must reduce the amount of droplets in the air.
Okay. So I think this has a lot of implications then for how we can do our teaching. So interestingly, what you said about face masks seems to be a bit in opposition to what the Dutch government says, because the typical story is that they don't really protect you against the virus, because then you need a medical mask and they're too scarce. But I think what you say, it's not about yourself, but it's about somehow avoiding that you infect other people. And that's why you have to wear even a simple face mask. Am I correct in understanding that?
It's both. Okay. It's both. I mean, it's the protection of yourself to some degree, which you achieve to some degree also with a homemade face mask. But it is in particular the reduction of droplets towards the environment. And this clearly helps, and we have seen many cases also in Europe where it helped quite a bit. And I'm sure it'll also come in the Netherlands. I mean, right now, they already introduced it by June 1st for public transportation. And it's kind of interesting that the coronavirus is only dangerous from June 1st in public transportation. So from my point of view, it's already dangerous before. It's sure that it'll come here sooner or later. And from my point of view, the sooner the better.
Yes.
In shops also in churches. Or lecture halls when you are sitting next to each other.
So there
of course, you should keep some distance anyhow.
Yes.
For extra protection, but the crucial issue is really the face mask.
Yes, so this is very good to hear. So there's also a question in the chat now of somebody who asks, can the UT then not just give lectures outside? Why can't we become the first open-air university? Detlef, what do you think?
Well, in summer, I think it's a good idea because there's wind and you will have dilution of these droplets. In summer, you can go outside. And in fact, in Germany, in school and kindergartens, I partly went outside. In winter, it's of course of some trouble. You can't do that. And that's why I'm really worried on the upcoming winter, October, November, when people can't be outside so much. I'm really worried on this, and I hope by then the outbreaks will be so much under control that it will be less of a problem.
Mariella, what do you think? Teaching outside, you are the director of education and psychology. Would that work? Would you consider?
Yeah, I would love it. I like to be outside. But I think also the danger would be when you feel more safe, also when wearing, for instance, these face masks, when you feel more safe, people also forget about the guidelines more. So that might also be problematic.
Yeah, okay. So there's always this behavior aspect beside the technical aspect.
Yeah.
There's the movement of the droplets, but there's, of course, also that people feel, I'm outside.
Yeah.
Why worry?
It's exactly. Yeah.
But maybe also for teaching, I mean, if a choir is already dangerous, there's somebody singing, exhales quite explicitly. But what about somebody teaching, Detlef? Isn't that as dangerous for a student as listening to a choir when you're in church?
Well, I mean, if you are sitting too close and if some droplets come out of your mouth, which in particular happens when you speak very, very loud, then clearly it's dangerous. I mean, we see these outbreaks in pubs, where there's music, people speak loud and get close to each other. It's a very dangerous situation. And I rather would teach in a big lecture hall with only a few students far away and also far away from each other, and in particular also with the extra protection of face masks.
Maybe it's the ultimate way.
In very small lecture rooms where you are very close, I mean, it's at this moment, it's not safe, and you can't do this, and for good reasons, it's not done. I hope that in September, October, you will partly resume the teaching inside. So, I mean, you can teach small class and TA and so on in big rooms with only, say, 20 people. I mean, this is safe, but I mean, I am afraid that big lectures with 200, 300 people squeezed in some lecture hall, that this is not a good idea for the time being. I mean, even with face masks. Maybe face masks will come with these lectures.
We have finally found the ultimate way to have silent students in the classroom, because the more noise they make, the louder we have to speak, and the dangerous, the more dangerous we are.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, this is quite serious, I think. I mean, we try to imagine the 1.5 meter society in general, but also the 1.5 meter university. So it basically means that when classes start again and fall is coming, we can only teach in small groups.
Yes.
Do you somehow already prepare for this situation? Can you say a bit about how you deal with that?
Yeah, we prepare for the situation very much, of course. So I think most teachers are aware that also in September, October, maybe November as well, the lectures should be given online as well. And only the small work groups, of course, in a bigger room than normally, can actually proceed offline.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So it means small-scale education. We happen to be good at that already in 20, so that's maybe a fortunate situation.
Yeah.
Exactly. Maybe one last thing about the physics of droplets, Detlef. You also hear things about air conditioning. And of course, some of our buildings have air conditioning, almost all of them. Is that extra dangerous, or is it maybe extra safe because it's less humid, maybe, if you have air conditioning? What's the physics of the virus in
air conditioning is crucial, and I would hope that the air conditioning systems at the University of Twente are modern and well taken care of, with filters and so on, and in particular with the used air directly going outside. I mean, there have been cases of infections through the air conditioning systems in China, in hospitals, so proven cases. And I think that also at these cruise ships that so many people get infected is not incidental. I mean, I would guess, though there's no proof, that this partly happens through this air conditioning system.
Okay.
So you need good filters. And what you also need, I mean, even without air conditioning, is a flux of air through the rooms. In fact, already in 1919, after the Spanish flu, there was a famous science article called Lessons from the Pandemic. And one of these lessons was that you have to make sure that there's always fresh air in your room. And fresh air in a way that you open the window on one side, and or at the same time, on the other side, that you have a through flux of air through the room. And this would help. And, air conditioning must be taken care of extremely well. So with filters and with the used air going directly outside.
Wow. Interesting. 1919, you said. So 100 years ago.
In fact, when you read this article, it's in Science 1919. When you read this article, it reads like an article from these days.
Incredible.
It's remarkable. And
so what does that say about science?
Technology achieved a lot, but they didn't learn yet how to avoid this pandemic.
Wow. That's indeed maybe even shocking to realize that we already know so much that we maybe reinvent, despite all the articles that we are writing that 100 years later, they can still be discovered as something new. Interesting. Well, thank you very much, Detlef. This was very interesting. So I think the conclusion is we need to wear face masks at our university. We need to keep a distance from our teachers.
It's pretty clear, not only at the university, but jobs, for public transportation. I mean, that's the way to go. I mean, it's really very, very, very clear message.
Exactly. Thank you very much, Detlef, for joining us tonight. Thank you.
Well, you're welcome.
So, we have talked a lot about 1.5 meter distancing, Marjelle, but as a psychologist, of course, I think you can also maybe inform us a bit about how that affects us as human beings. Somebody said to me last week, 1.5 meter society is a bad word because this is not a society anymore, 1.5 meters. What kind of interaction do you have? What kind of meaningful human contact can you have? How do you see that?
Yeah, you can debate about whether you're still society, but at least we're less connected than we used to be, especially now since all of us are working at home, right? There is less connection. We have connection via the media, but it's quite different from, of course, the connection that we used to have. And we as humans want to live in groups. We want to be connected with each other. We need human contact. We need physical contact. because it helps us to also stay mentally healthy, but also physically healthy.
So what happens to us if we lack that? If you really are lonely, deprived of social contact?
People who are lonely or people who are on a desert island, they actually feel depressed. They have a lot of physical symptoms as well, so they're actually sick. Sometimes they hallucinate even. Wow. So it's not good for people to stay disconnected.
And that also involves physical connection. It's not just having a phone call every now and then or Skype, for that matter.
Yeah, so those types of interactions help. So if you have the one-on-one interactions with people via social media, they actually increase your well-being. Yeah. Not when you just, of course, look at your Facebook, what everyone else is doing. That doesn't help at all. But people need also to feel each other, to touch each other, to feel each other's warmth. Because it also releases a hormone, which is called oxytocin. We call it the cuddle hormone. And the cuddle hormone is also released when you just touch one another or you feel each other's warmth. And people actually need that to feel safe, to feel connected, and to build their relationships.
Yes, interesting. So if we lack that, then it makes us feel worse.
Yes.
So I think that there's a whole discourse now in society that we're also discovering, forced by the circumstances, that we can actually also be kind of near to each other. I attended a funeral yesterday, actually, online. And before that happened, I thought, oh, this is going to be so hard to feel connected. But it was actually very intimate and very close. Of course, I would have wanted to cuddle our friend who lost her mother. But still, people hope, at least, maybe that the digital technologies can bring about these intense connections. So could this change? I mean, could we develop oxytocin also in a technologically mediated way, or do we really need to touch skin, the skin hunger that people speak about?
That's an interesting question. I think people really need to touch each other, but I'm not sure whether you would use a technology with robot arms, seeing another person actually also taking care of the robot arm so that you know that the other person does it, whether that would release oxytocin, that we could investigate that.
Yeah, I mean, that there are systems for being present on a distance where you can actually touch, of course, a robotic agent, and that represents a person, and then the hope is that it would not totally replace, but at least give the suggestion that you are with that person.
Yeah, it at least does something for your well-being, indeed. Yeah.
Yeah, so that could maybe be kind of a bridge.
Yeah, but another bridge could be, if we cannot have human contact, you can actually make sure you pet your cat or your dog, because that also releases the hormone.
So someone in the audience asks, if a robot feels like human skin, would that be a solution rather than your cat or your dog? I have an allergy for cats, so... Could I use a robot instead? Or do we need a human being behind a robot?
We definitely need a human being behind it, but we do know that if it's a robot, people actually already think similar thoughts being a human. So it would work, but not as strongly as
actual human beings. Okay, so it's still like having a conversation through digital media.
Yeah.
It's almost there.
But it's better than nothing,
Exactly. Interesting. So, of course, this is about the 1.5 meter society, and it's about the environment for our students. Actually, that's also why we do the campus talks in English, because this is also a way to engage our international students. And actually, one of our students made an app. There was a hackathon, the EU versus the virus hackathon. Student Gleb Podorozhny, sorry, it's such a difficult name to say, Gleb. I apologize. A student at our university, Creative Technology, actually won a prize. And the app actually has as the ambition to establish a true human connection by means of a computer, the Mentor.me app. And actually, we asked him to explain the app a little bit in a short clip, which we will show now. Please watch it.
The Mentor.me app is a platform that connects mentors and students. To be exact, we are targeting mentors, volunteers, such as university students, parents, and teachers, and students from high school and secondary education. The basic concept is that a student can take a picture of their question, something they need help with, record a voice recording, etc., post it on the app, and mentors instantly get a notification, somebody picks it up, and you get connected by video right away, so that you can help a student for 1, 2, 5, sometimes 10 minutes and assist them in their assignment or a question that they might have. This way we create equivalent of raising your hand in a digital classroom in order to keep the human touch besides just Googling answers. For a lot of students, the 1.5 meter society has a lot of negative impact. So not only for students, but people in general. It creates distance between us already in a society that's ever more growingly distant. And I think it can be really damaging to a lot of students because spending half a year or 1 year in such an education way at such a distance can teach us children to be less personal. And a lot of them can lose that personal connection and personal touch. I think what the challenge we'll be facing with is how do we keep these digital tools very humane and having a lot of personal touch in them, although they are being done digitally. A question that I have regarding student psychology is how do we in this new hybrid form of education, how do we teach children how to behave, how to acquire the skills that they need when studying at home by themselves, when you are not present with them? What can be done to assist students in the way of dealing with their psychology and teaching them how to actually learn online and by themselves?
Beautiful questions, I think. Also, very nice to see this app. Maybe we should speak about the app later, but first, well, how do you and maybe also myself teach our students not only the intellectual part, but also the maybe existential part of being a student?
Yeah, exactly. So it's quite hard to do that when you do not have a lot of contact with them, especially the new students who start in September. You kind of want to bond with them more than only online, right? So it makes it hard. And of course, we do have a lot of mentors mentoring those students one-on-one, and it can also be done digitally and online, which is fine. But most people really would like something more than just the online. But I think this app is a great app to stimulate us.
Yeah. I mean, director of Maastricht University, Rianne Letschert, who I know very well, very beautifully said, well, at the university, of course, you earn your study points, your study credits, but you also earn your life points.
Yes.
And this is maybe what we take away. My oldest son is a first year student in Utrecht University, and he had a great start, but now suddenly he's having hardly any social interaction, and this is what it's maybe all about. So, maybe we could take that seriously as a university.
Yeah.
But this app is also an interesting idea, actually, to establish a closer connection between teachers and students. Would that fit, do you think, in an academic practice of us working from home now? Could this be a way to be closer to students?
Yeah, I think that this is a good way to be closer to students than we are doing now, especially because you have the one-on-one contact, which is really important to establish a connection in the first place. So it's better than doing the group online sessions.
Yeah.
But of course, you can question how much time teachers have to do that with all the workload.
A difficult thing. Eh? That's the weird thing, that the workload seems to go down,
yes,
but it actually goes up.
It goes up.
Digitalizing all your education. That's also maybe to answer Gleb's question. And I think also for myself, you try maybe more to organize the learning process than to convey the intellectual stuff.
Yep.
And, when I teach, normally it's also what I try to do. I think they can read the text and class is for fun. So what I try to do is just to have some nice movies to watch and to have some kind of a red thread through that I give them, hopefully as an inspirational source to give depth to the text that they can read. But of course, it's not a real substitute for the experience of somebody standing there and conveying the enthusiasm, etc. So maybe this app could work. And it's interesting to see that it's there. I think maybe as a university, we should try to keep things like this seriously.
Very nice. Yeah.
We have to spend our time, maybe not to have the next super fancy digital class, but just spend one day a week on this.
Exactly. That's a good idea. Yeah. And I'm also curious, you wrote a lot of interesting books, of course, how technology influences how we view the world and how we view other people. Do you have an idea to what extent technology can mediate and establishing a true interaction between people?
that's a tough one. Well, I do believe that true contact is possible through technologies. And that we are maybe we have changed our views on this over the course of time. I mean, Digital contact has become so normal now that it feels very close to people. I think there were also times that it would not feel like something you should do if you, say that you want to end your relationship through a letter, or maybe even say somebody that you love a person through a letter, because a letter, you need physical presence. And also, you write a letter if you really love somebody, otherwise you send an email, right? So I think these media change over time, and we have to get used to them. We have to learn to work with them. And the more we integrate them into ourselves, the more they become an extension of us and the less artificial they feel.
Yeah.
So that would be my hope somehow for the 1.5 meter society, that we learn a little bit more to see those media as part of us, and that we don't notice them anymore, that we feel close. I'm not sure if they could bring oxytocin, but maybe you do not always need that, or we should stick to the real contact for the oxytocin. But for teaching, as I said, the funeral that I attended yesterday was a very special experience, which for the first time I thought, wow, if you can be so close to such an event that is so deeply existential, and you really feel that it's almost as if you have been there, and you can speak, and we can speak with our friend as if we have been there. We see, we saw what she said, how she felt, etc. I think, this is interesting. This is not just as if you're watching a distant movie and doing something. We were there. So I hope that by appropriating the technologies, we can maybe get a bit closer to people that we see. Yeah, so, of course, it is not only about being physically close to other people. It's maybe also about staying healthy. That's maybe one of the other effects of the 1.5 meter society. We sit behind our screens as people, and that also makes people depressed, I think, has been shown a lot. And actually, our crew interviewed Jasper Reynalda, a human movement scientist connected to the Roesing here in Enschede, to explain the importance of exercising. Let's watch that.
Staying at home or at a safe distance from others doesn't mean you have to quit exercising. How bad is it to stop moving?
Well, actually, pretty bad. It's a logical reasoning to stop exercising when you have to stay at home. But you can still go out and do a lot of exercise. When you stop completely, especially if you are used to exercise on a regular basis, it's detrimental to your physical condition as well as to your mental health.
How about your physical condition?
Your physical condition is always a balance between the load that you have and the ability that you have to withstand load. And normally you want to improve that. If you stop exercising, you take away the load. And it means that your body quickly adapts to a lesser load, decreases the ability to withstand loads.
And the effect on your mind?
Especially if you're used to exercise on a regular basis. When you take that away, people can get very sad about it.
Do you have simple exercises for us?
Well, it's easy to go out for a walk. That's already if you go out for a walk every day. For instance, when you're working from home, during lunch break, you go out for a walk. On the other hand, if you're used to running 3 times a week, you can still run 3 times a week. For other sports, like team sports, which is more difficult, especially to keep that 1.5 meter rule, if you're engaging in team sports, you can still work out from home.
Last tip?
If you have a garden with a trampoline in it, typically for the kids, but you can jump on the trampoline. Well, build it up gradually or you might get injured. But that's a good way to already improve your physical health.
So, Mariella, do you have a garden with a trampoline in it?
No, I do have a balcony, and I like to dance on my balcony, so I do that.
Don't use a trampoline on your balcony, I would say. So, seriously, what do you do to stay healthy, if I may ask?
Yeah, actually, normally I like to run 3 times a week, but now watching the video, and now during Corona, I just had a high workload and I dropped it, but having seen this video, I think I should pick it up again. And okay. You?
Yeah, well, I try to run once a week. But it's also getting harder. At the beginning, I actually did it quite a lot, or I went out to do the shopping walking rather than taking the bicycle. But of course, you get used to the situation and the workload gets higher and higher. So that's really the risk, I think, sitting all the time and Maybe, well, it's also good to keep an eye on your weight, at least for myself, that's a good thing. So that might be the ultimate motivation to do a little bit more of running. But I also noticed actually that going back to the air we exhale and the droplets, that running can also bring you in situations that don't feel comfortable, right? Yeah. The times that I go running are typically the times that many other people do that,
yes,
as well.
Yeah.
So you're behind people and, well, you smell them and you... you feel maybe this is not a very good thing to do. So that's maybe in a sense dangerous.
It can be dangerous. Yeah.
Somebody in the audience said a French man actually ran a marathon on his balcony. So wouldn't that be a good idea, Maria?
Yeah, I've seen the video. I liked it very much. But I think his balcony was somewhat longer than mine. So I was quite jealous. Yeah.
Okay.
But
so
it would be a good idea. It's safe. Yeah.
Moving to a bigger apartment might be. But it is indeed interesting to see how many things people do to stay healthy.
Yeah.
And maybe in my case, it also helps me a lot that our youngest son really likes to play soccer a lot.
Oh, okay,
I'm
nice.
Not a good soccer player, but every day he wants his 15 minutes of winning from his father. So that's what I try to do then. So wonderful. Well, I think we had a very interesting evening. We discussed a lot of elements of the 1.5 meter society, from the air we inhale to the impact on our psychological well-being and the impact on our education. Thank you so much for being here with us. It was wonderful.
Thank you.
And in 2 weeks, we will have another episode. Actually, then we have a look at the economic impact of the virus. And well, let's have a look at the teaser for this third episode.
A lot of students earn money by working in restaurants and pubs. Because of the lockdown, they are not able to earn their living. How does this affect their study?
I noticed that we have actually a lot more assignments than we had physically.
Their life.
I will have to raise my student loan, I think.
And their future.
The way things were, I don't think we can go back to that anymore. So I'm curious to see what will happen, but I have no clue what that would mean.
An exciting episode, I think. So in the studio we have aviation journalist Hans Heerkens, also a scientist from our university, actually reflecting on the future of aviation, which is of course a very big thing, which also might affect academic life a lot. I mean, we fly a lot, travel a lot. We also discovered that it maybe could be a bit less. At least I almost feel embarrassed thinking now of how much I flew and how much we can do, how well we can do without it. So Hans Heerkens will be here in the studio. Victor van der Scheis, the chair of the board of the University of Twente, will also be here online, explaining actually what the crisis means for our own university. So it's going to be very exciting. I hope to see you all back in 2 weeks from now. In the meantime, stay fit, stay healthy, and stay safe, and please keep other people safe as well. See you in 2 weeks. Bye-bye.